In every facet of life, we are surrounded by intentional design. From agriculture to Fortune 500 companies, everything happens as a result of careful planning and design. We realize the destiny God has for us through designing a life worth living. Join us now for Designing Your Destiny.
How'd you like that? That was our attempt at the Morgan Freeman impersonation. Join us now. Hope I can live up to that. But we are starting a new series this week, Achieving Your Destiny. And we're going to be, it's a good time to, beginning of 2016, but the beginning of a year to think through, you know, where am I going? How am I going to get there? What are our goals? And if you know, if you live long enough, you figure out that goals don't just come naturally. achieving something takes a little bit of planning, a little bit of work, some effort. And it's easy to get caught up in the tyranny of the urgent. You're just running, doing errands, doing this, going to work. You've got so many things going on. That can easily get pushed to the back burner where it's not a priority. And then you just kind of live from week to week, month to month, and then year to year. And then you look back and you really don't have thought through plans. And so you're not accomplishing and you're not making forward progress like you want. So that's why it's important to carve out time, which we're going to do as a church. We're encouraging you to do it individually and just say, you know, over this next month, not just for 2016, but we're going to encourage you to think out 10 years. 10 years out for your life. Now, many of you, probably most of you, have never done that. And so that's why it's going to take us a month to kind of figure out how do we do this, and get us fired up to even want to do it. Because sometimes we can just think, well, what's the use? Well, there's a big reason to do it. God loves it when we get involved in the plan he has for us. And he does have a plan for you. You know, when we talk about this idea of destiny, you know, designing your destiny. Sometimes people think to themselves when they think of destiny, it's like, you know, it's like life's like karma. You know, destiny is like something that's going to happen regardless of what, if you have anything to do with it or not. It's like fate. And in the Bible, that's just not true. Now, that is the way that Islam looks at it and Buddhism, but Christianity, when you look at Scripture, you see that God says, no, actually, we get to walk into our destiny. It's something we choose or not to choose, or not to do. Two things are true about our destiny. One is that your destiny that God has for you, his plan for you is something that's good. It's good. Some people don't understand that. I love this verse in Jeremiah 29:11. It says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper, circle that word prosper, you, and not to harm you, plans to give you hope, circle that word, and a future. See, that's God's plan for you. Sometimes we project onto God, maybe our upbringing or our temperament or all these things. And we think, well, God's probably got it in for me. And he's got all this painful stuff, all these things that are going to be bad for me. But actually, the Bible says God's got good things waiting for you. The second thing is that it's your choice. I get to choose my destiny. You can choose to walk into that. You can choose to ignore it. Now, God's got a plan and a purpose for your life, but it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to take the time to figure that out, to walk in that. If you do discover, to obey it, all those things. That's part of our mission of our church, is to help you figure out your purpose for life and to live in that. And we're committed to that. We want to rally around that. It's really, like I said, part of our mission. Because it's so important. What could be more important than you discovering God's purpose for your life and then you fulfilling that? I can't think of anything more important than that. That sounds pretty doggone important. So we're going to, like I said, spend some time talking about that, saying, hey, how do we make that happen? Now, excuse me, I have a little bit of a cold, as you can see. Now, to talk about this, I'm going to go back to an Old Testament story, Joshua. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to Joshua chapter 1. We're actually going to begin in Deuteronomy because that's where the story kind of picks up. Oh, thanks, George. that's where the story picks up. But I want to just give some background real quick to this story. You have the Israelites were in slavery for over 400 years. Moses comes along. He leads the children of Israel out of this bondage in Egypt that they had been in. And, you know, the 10 plagues and through the Red Sea, they go to Mount Sinai. And as they leave Egypt, it's only 2 weeks to get from Egypt to Israel, to the Promised Land. And it ends up taking them 40 years because they get to the edge of the Promised Land and they get waylaid by fear and doubt. They send in some spies to kind of scope it out. And those guys come back and they, 10 out of the 12 say something very negative. They say, you know, we're like grasshoppers in their eyes. It's going to be terrible. It's going to be hard. We can't do it. We're going to be crushed. And so what happens is all the Israelites hear this story. They buy into that. That's not God's best plan for them. They buy into that, though, and then they end up deciding, well, we're not going to go in. And they end up wandering around for 40 years. 40 years later, they're ready to go now into the Promised Land. They're on the edge of the Jordan River. They have to cross the Jordan River to get into the Promised Land. And God is speaking to them. He's speaking to them through Moses. And that's where we pick this up here. It says, I set before you today life and prosperity or death and destruction. So here you have this choice. He's going, I'm giving you this choice. You can choose life and prosperity or death and destruction. He says, if you love the Lord your God and you walk in his ways and you keep his commands, then you will live and you will increase. And the Lord your God will bless you, so circle that word bless, in the land that you are entering to possess. So God says, I want to bless you. I want you to step into this, but this is your destiny, but it is your choice. It's your choice. You can do that or you can choose not to, just like 40 years ago you chose not to. Here you're at the same kind of precipice. Are you going to step into it or are you not? He says, but if your heart turns away from me and you will not live long in the land. He goes, in other words, it's not going to matter anyways if you don't live for me and trust in me. He goes, you're choosing the Jordan to enter and possess. I have set before you, again, this choice, life or death, blessings or curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live. A couple of things about this verse. Number one is that he does have a destiny for the children of Israel. He says, I want you to go in. I have something great for you, and I want you to choose this, choose life. And then also notice that it even affects their children. You see, what happens, the choices you make will affect other people. If you have kids, it affects your kids, the people around us. It affects us. It affects other people. And so he says, it's even going to affect the kids. Now, I want us to be thinking bigger, kind of like what he says. It's not just about you, but even the people you impact. And that's why I said, let's think 10 years out, because 10 years is a lot. For some of you in 10 years, you're single and you'll be married in 10 years. Some of you are thinking, I hope it doesn't take that long. I don't know, but all I know is 10 years is a long time. For 10 years, some of you are going to be retired in 10 years. Some, if you have a second grader in 10 years, she'll be graduating. I mean, when you think of it like that, a lot happens in 10 years. And so when you think of 10 years, you think, well, this is, maybe part of God's plan for you means you're going to have to go back to school. And so there's retooling. See, so just sometimes when you just think 1 year, it's really not, you don't give yourself enough room to think about how God might work his plan out in your life. That's why it's good to kind of, 10 years isn't a magic number, but it's a good number. Just to say 10 years out. You know, what can God do in my life? And you start thinking about God's purpose for your life. Now, in order to achieve your purpose, you're going to be tempted with the same things, the challenge with the same things that Joshua had. That's why we're using him. Three things when you're thinking through your life's purpose, you're going to need to do these same three things that Joshua did. Okay, let's look at them. Number one is you need to have a plan. You got to prepare a plan. Now, I like to talk about plans. One of the reasons I like to talk about planning is it seems like for a number of Christians that I talk to, they feel like that's not a very spiritual experience. I mean, they kind of, well, you know, whatever God wants. Well, yeah, God is going to, he does have a will, but part he wants us to move into that. And that happens when we plan. Sometimes people think that it's not a spiritual experience. They think, well, that's being presumptuous, you know, or that's being selfish and these kinds of things. But planning, here, listen to this, is a spiritual activity. You know, you think of prayer and you think of reading your Bible, going to church, planning. I think it'd be awesome if you thought kind of in the, or maybe even put one higher up. I mean, planning is so important. So you prayerfully plan as you read the Bible and then come to church, especially this month, right? As you're sorting it out. So here's what it says in Joshua 1. God starts out with this. He says, after the death of Moses, the Lord said to Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, get ready to cross the river, the Jordan River, into the land I'm giving you. I will give you every place where you set your foot, just as I promised Moses. So he's going to outline his destiny. He says, your territory will extend from the Sinai Desert all the way up to Lebanon, and then from the Euphrates, which is in Iraq, all the way to the Great Sea, which is the Mediterranean Sea. Now, notice a couple of things here. First thing is he warns them not to get stuck in the past. So he just kind of, he already knew Moses was dead, but he just says, that part of your life, that chapter, that era is behind you. Don't get stuck there. There's a lot of reasons to get stuck there. Could you imagine taking over Israel Inc. as CEO after Moses? I mean, Moses, he's the man, right? I mean, he's the one who, you know, had created this, you know, God used him to have this idea of delivering the whole nation from bondage, 400 years of slavery, the 10 plagues, the Red Sea, the fire in the clouds and Mount Sinai and the law. He wrote the first five books of the Bible. That's a good start. And now he's taking over. And, you know, God's saying, hey, that's also, Moses was his mentor. His mentor was dead. So there's a lot of things for him to all of the great successes. You know, not failures can keep us stuck in the past, but so can successes. You know that? People, they get successful and then they start resting on their laurels and they coast. The next thing you know, they forfeit their future. This happens a lot in businesses. I was reading an article by Mark Zuckerberg about Facebook. He's the founder of Facebook. And when he moved to his headquarters in Menlo Park, California, they bought out another tech company that was a super high-powered, innovative tech company at one point, but they rested on their successes. The next thing you know, they're going under, and Facebook's buying them. So when Mark Zuckerberg bought it, he redid the whole place except for the sign. The sign, he just turned it around, put Facebook on the front part, their Facebook logo. That's what you'll see if you go to their headquarters. On the back, he kept it there. Look on the back of the sign. There it is, Sun Microsystems. So as people are leaving, he goes, I wanted to remember, this could be us if we start resting on our successes. You know, you're a defunct company. And so it's a constant reminder. You know, watch out for your past. This can happen to churches. Churches get stuck in their past for good or for bad. I mean, our movement here in the Vineyard, we've had some pretty big successes, not just the Vineyard, this Vineyard here, but we're part of a bigger movement. Bigger movement, we brought the third wave to the church globally, which transformed the thinking of the evangelical church to embrace the charismatic gifts. If you look it up, feel free, jump on Google. You can do it now if you can multitask. And you'll see that the Vineyard transformed the evangelical church globally. Also with the kingdom theology, the way the Pentecostals and the charismatics had been stuck in their understanding of the gifts and the way they pray for people. And so we brought in kingdom theology, also called inaugurated eschatology, or you can look it up in different words, but we transformed the thinking of how the gifts are employed by the charismatics and the Pentecostals worldwide. Vineyard brought that. Vineyard also brought in contemporary praise and worship music. It wasn't Hillsong. I'm glad that they're doing great. It was Vineyard with a little help of Calvary Chapel. But there's some older guys that were part of that. I was part of some of that. I've been in the Vineyard for almost 30 years, but some of that was even before me, that they remember that and they were part of that. I mean, I was in the Vineyard, but I wasn't producing the music or part of that at all. And so some of those people that were, they're stuck. Every time I talk to them, every conference I go to, they start talking about 30, 35 years ago when the Vineyard was making global headlines. It's not doing that anymore. A lot of people have never heard of the Vineyard anymore. And so there's a call to the Vineyard. Hey, don't get stuck in your past, whether it's successful or whether it's, or whether it's a painful past. I know people that, because it can happen personally where you get stuck just because you had some trauma happen. You got a divorce and you didn't think it would happen, or your parents got divorced, or somebody died who you loved, and you can get stuck there. That's just, you live with all those memories. Hey, memories, for good or for bad, can keep you stuck in the past. And so he's telling them, be careful. Don't let that happen. You know, you need to move forward. And God says, get ready. Get ready. Which means get ready, right? It means God's going to do something. Get ready to cross the River Jordan. There's something new that's going to happen. Maybe you have great memories. Awesome. Maybe you have painful memories. Bummer. But get ready for something God's going to do in your life. So you need to think through what, get ready for the next 10 years God's going to do for you. I read a study. It's actually a famous study this week that said 27% of Americans have given no thought to their future. 27%. 60% of Americans have given some thought to their future. Usually it's just in the area of finances. But 60% have just given a little thought to their future. Only 10% of Americans have given serious thought to their future. And 3% of Americans have a written down plan for their future. They've thought about it, they've written it down, and they have goals attached to it. Then they went back to these four groups. And this is what they discovered about them. The first group, the 27% who have given no thought to their future, nearly 100% of them are on welfare. 27%, are there even 20% people on welfare? It's actually, there's 35% of Americans are on welfare, 35%. But 100% of this group nearly was on welfare. And then the 60% who had just given some thought to their future, we're barely making ends meet. Barely making it. Just scraping out from day to day a life. The 10%, all of them were successful. The people who had thought through their future, had a plan, they were successful in multiple domains of their life. And anybody looking at them would say, yeah, they're doing really good. And then the 3% were highly successful, some of the top achievers in their field. And then they looked at the difference between the 10% and the 3%. The 10% giving thought to their future, serious thought with a plan, 3% actually writing it down with goals attached, and they found that there was no difference in their talent or their education, only the fact that they had taken the time to write down their goals and attach their plan and attach goals to it. It's important. This is a distinguishing factor between if God is going to be able to bless you. Are you going to take the time to get out of the hustle and bustle of life, all of the deadlines and the tyranny of the urgent, and carve out some time and say, God, what do you want to do with my life? What are you going to do over the next 10 years? You get ready. You get a plan. Verse 10, it says, so Joshua ordered the leaders, and if you're a leader here, this is a word for you. Go through the camp and tell everyone, prepare your provisions. In 3 days, you'll cross the Jordan and you'll go and you're going to go in and take and possess and take possession of the land that the Lord your God is giving you for your own. So he's saying, prepare your provisions. In other words, get ready, pack your bags. Be ready for God to do something in your life. So you need to pack your bags and think through, you know, what's the next decade of my life going to be like? Is there some music going on? It's kind of cool, actually. It's kind of like, felt like I was emphasizing. Let's do that again. And think through family. What's going on with your family? What's going on with your education, with your job, with your church, your spiritual growth? Where do you want to be with your relationship with Jesus over the next 10 years? Do you want it to be where it is today? With your small group, your ministry? I love this verse. Psalm 20, verse 4 says, May God give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. Have you ever thought of that? That's, what a great verse. Some of you didn't even know that was in there. God wants your plans to succeed. But, of course, if you don't have any plans, it's hard for that to happen, right? He wants to make your plans succeed, but you got to have some plans. So God, for some of you, he's just waiting on you. The Bible says that there is wisdom in planning. You go through Proverbs and you see. In Proverbs, he talks about the planning, how important it is. Well, he gives an example a couple times of ants. It says how important, look at the ant on how they plan. And he says, we need to be like the ant. You know, it's interesting that with genetics, now they can actually take DNA and put it, they put DNA from spiders into goats. Did you know that? And so now the goats in their mammary glands, so when the goats produce milk, it's actually like a spider web thing going on. You know, it's spider proteins that are coming out. That's kind of weird, right? I was thinking it'd be cool if they could figure out how to put ant DNA in us. You know, wouldn't that be, make us like super workers, super focused, good planners. It would just be kind of part of our DNA, just like ants are. I'm kind of kidding. Because then it's too easy. It's your choice. See, ants do it because God created them that way. For us, he gave us a choice. He said, you're not an ant, but I want you to be like an ant without the ant DNA. So do you have a life plan? Do you have something that's moving you forward? You're thinking it through. Jesus said, a king doesn't plan a battle. I mean, go into battle without a plan. Jesus said, a builder doesn't build a tower without a plan. You've got to have a plan. We have plans in business. We have plans in military strategies. You need a plan for your life. Proverbs 20, verse 18 says, don't go charging into battle without a plan. Now, of course, we give God the right to change our plan because we're not perfect. We don't see the future perfectly. We don't always know what's around the corner. And that's what James says. He goes, make sure and be flexible in your plan. Don't get upset if God wants to change your plan. He says, when you plan. Now notice it says when you plan, not if you plan. He says, when you plan. He says, don't say we're going to do this or this or this. Say we're going to do this or this or this if it's the Lord's will. So there's room for God to come in and speak into your plan. You don't get all bent out of shape. What I've noticed, though, when we talk about plans and goals is that most of us don't know how to do it. We even want to do it. Many of you, when I'm talking, you're going, yeah, I've wanted to do that for years. I just don't know. I mean, I don't do it. And if you really analyze it, you think, I just don't know how. I mean, we weren't taught in school. When we talk to our leaders and our staff here at the church, we'll say, we need you to have your goals. We need goals for each ministry leader. And then for when we put together our budget, we take our goals and then we say, okay, what are you going to need to make your ministry happen? And then putting together a budget that matches with the goals, we submit that to our financial board, and then they help pull all that together. But what we find over and over, nearly 100%, is people don't know how to do that. They don't know how to set goals. They just don't. They've just never been done. So there's a process that goes into that. That's why it would be unfair for me to sit here or stand here and try to motivate you to make a plan with goals attached to it, written down, that God wants to do in your life, and then not help you and equip you with that, right? That wouldn't be fair. And so we have a a book that a workbook that we have that all our small groups are going to be involved in. And we encourage you to get into a small group because it's something you do together with accountability, with encouragement. And we've already paid for it. So the book's already got your name on it. It's waiting for you at a Connect group. And it goes along with the messages. We're going to, through the messages and through our small groups and this study book that we have, it'll go through step by step how to lay out a life plan for you with goals attached, written out. So by the end of January, if you get involved in a Connect group, by the end of January, you'll have that. And for probably the vast majority, it'll be the first time you've ever had a life plan for you. There it is, a life plan. Why not take time to do that? Most people put more time into planning a vacation than they do for their own life. Certainly most women who get married take more time planning their wedding, which is one day, than their life plan, which is their whole life. Why not take the month of January with us? We'll do it together and plan it out and say, okay, this is going to be my life plan for at least for the next 10 years with, I understand God can change it. And you have it written down. You got to get involved now. And we're going to have a small group for next weekend. So next weekend, you'll be able to meet the small group leaders. You'll be able to decide, hey, I really connect with a small group leader or the one that's closest to you. If you're not going to be here next weekend, you can just write on your Connect card today, hey, I want to be in a small group. I won't be there next weekend. We'll be sure to call you and we'll give you all the options, talk you through it over the phone. But you want to get involved in a Connect group so that you can be part of what we're doing. We're going to do it. All the small groups are going to be doing the same thing. Okay, so if you're in a small group, it's already got you. Don't worry about it. It's already going to happen. But if you're not, we want you to be part of one. Proverbs 16:3 says, commit to the Lord whatever you do, then your plans will succeed. Now listen, I'm committed to your success. Our church is committed to your success. Our mission statement in our church, which is to be a contemporary extension of the good news to our community, help people find and fulfill God's call on their life, God's purpose in their life. That's our mission statement, is to help you be successful in what we're talking about today. And so we want to see you do it. We want to see you do well. And making a plan. On the back of your outline, number two, I must build my life completely on God's word. Not just the foundation. And that's important to ask Christ into your life, but everything in your house is part of God's word. The doors, the windows, the roof, the kitchen, everything in your life, you build it on God's word. Joshua, there, it's another piece of advice that God's given him to as he's possessing the promised land. He says, but, God says to Joshua, be careful to obey, not some, but what? All of the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful. So circle that word, successful. What's the option? What's the alternative, right? Failure. He doesn't want you to be a failure. He wants you to be successful. Wherever you go, study this book of the law continually. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. So I want you to circle a couple words there. First, where he says, obey. So these are ways that we can interact with God's word, interact with getting input from the Lord. As one is we just obey what he says. Then he says, study the book. You can circle that. And then meditate, which means you think seriously about it. And then he says, be careful to do it. That's always nice, to do what he says. Now, in our Vineyard Class 201, which we offer nearly every month, we cover these things, cover about how important it is to study God's word and meditate on it and memorize it and to do it. And we talk about integrating these habits and these spiritual disciplines in your life. That's important. It's part of what it means to be a Christ follower. That's why we do it. That's why we've been doing it for year after year. We don't like come up with a new, let's come up with something new. No, it's foundational. So we think this has to be in place. Some of you don't have this in place. And so maybe you need to take 201. Maybe you took it, but you need a refresher course. So you just come on back. Okay. So say, hey, I'm back at 201. This might be your 10th time. And that's cool. I'll just say, hey, I'm a slow learner. I'm here for the free pizza, whatever you want. I don't really care. You just come, but you say, I need the stuff in my life. I need to make sure I'm building my life on God's word and understanding it. You don't need just another Bible study. You need to be able to do what God tells you to do. So you do whatever it takes in order to make that happen. And he says, don't turn from the right or to the left. In other words, there's a lot of things that can sidetrack us. A lot of things that can get us off our mission. It's called mission drift. You get even when at the end of this, and I'm going to speak in faith, we all go through this class, in our connect groups. We all have a written down plan. We're going to be part of the 3%. There's still a temptation for mission drift. If you just put that away, file it away, and never look at it again, you'll succumb to mission drift. You gotta. That becomes your template. Okay, I'm going to be working on this. This is the direction I'm going. Psalm 34:10 says, "Those who seek the Lord will lack no good thing." That's an amazing promise. No good thing is lacking for those who seek in the Lord. You go, well, I'm lacking good things. What's going on? Well, you might want to evaluate what you're seeking, because he says, "Those who seek the Lord, not those who seek peace." Those who seek comfort, those who seek prosperity, those who seek wealth. I mean, there's a lot of things that we want those things, but when we seek those things, a lot of times we don't find them. He says, when you seek the Lord, those things come. Jesus said, put first the kingdom of God, and then all these other things will be added to you. That's the way things work. You seek God first, and then he adds those other things that we want and need. But it's all about what you're seeking. What are you seeking first? Psalm 14:2 says, "The Lord looks down from heaven on the sons of men to see if there are any who understand." In other words, understand what life's about. "And if any are seeking the Lord." He's looking. Who's willing to serve me? Those are the people I'm going to bless. Those are the people I'm going to bless. And I want to let you know, I want to be one of those people that God looks and says, "Hey, you know, look at Andy. He wants to serve me." When I want the devil to be upset when I wake up. Oh, dang, he's up. You know, all he does is harass me all day long. You know, I want to be somebody who's changing the world around me in small ways and in big ways. And then number three, courageously step out in faith. Courageously step out in faith. Joshua is standing there at the edge of the Jordan River. And three times God says this phrase. He says, be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. They're in verses 6, 7, and 9. Why did he have to repeat it three times? Well, one of them is Joshua. You know, look at his predecessor, Moses. You know, bigger than life. People are going to tend to compare him, right? Now, you're not quite like Moses. We like Moses. And even though Moses did, you can read through Moses' life, he did plenty wrong. There's plenty of times when they didn't really like Moses. But we tend to forget that, right? Especially when there's a new leader. Oh, Moses was amazing. Is that right? But that's the way it goes, right? Human nature. So he says, be careful. You know, he goes, be strong and courageous. Another reason that he says that is because whenever you move into what God's plan for you, is it's going to come with a fight. It doesn't come on a platter. There's battles and blessings. You battle and you get a blessing. You battle, it comes with a fight. And so you're going to have to fight. It's not going to just come as a cakewalk. In fact, it's easier to do something else. If you're looking for the easy route, that's not God's plan for you. God's plan for you will involve hard work. It'll involve getting up early, going without sleep, sacrificing probably financially, sacrificing in other ways. I mean, it's gonna be a challenge. So he says, be strong and courageous. That's the word for you if you're gonna step into God's plan for you in 2016 and beyond. You have to be strong and courageous. Joshua knew that the minute he walked across the Jordan River, it was an act of war. There was seven other tribes or nations that were there that were better equipped. They had a military. He didn't have a military. They had been, you know, they were bigger than him. All of these things. And he knew that the minute he stepped into that, it was an act of war. And so he knew what the stakes were the minute he walked over. Now, if you're going to go into God's plan for your life, you're going to have both of these things, battles and blessings. Here's what you need to remember. Number one is God is with me. God's with me, just like he was with Joshua. He says, no one will be able to defeat you all of your life, he tells Joshua. Just as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave or abandon you. Jesus said the same thing, right? I won't leave or abandon you. Jesus says, I'm going to be with you. You start following me, God's going to be with you. That's good to know. That's good to remind yourself. Number two, God keeps his promises. This gives us boldness and confidence, knowing the character of God is to keep his promises. Verse 6, it says, be determined and confident, for you will lead these people to possess the land I promised to the previous generation. In other words, God's promise goes beyond just the first generation. This church is 21 years old. Sharon and I started at 21 years ago. We have people in leadership now that weren't even born when we started the church. That's a generation. In the Bible, a generation was 20, 30 years, something like that. And so we've already moved in now to a second generation. Has impact. God's promises, as we live faithfully out what God's doing in our life, it reverberates throughout history. Our legacy, the impact to other generations. And then third, God has told me to do it. See, it's God's idea that he has a plan for you, and he wants you to risk take and go for it. Verse 9, he says, have I not commanded you to do this? In other words, he's saying, you got to remember, this is God's plan that's unfolding here. So be courageous, strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. There's a tendency to be afraid or discouraged because those are the enemies. You know, fear. What if something goes wrong? What if I fall flat on my face? Discouragement. All those kinds of things. They get in the way. You know, when they were going to cross the Jordan River, this was at flood stage. Now, the Jordan River is actually a much smaller river during most of the year. And now it's dam controlled today, but even with a dam, it's more like it was during non-flood time over in Israel, where you can just, I've seen it, you can just throw a rock over it. It's more like a creek than it is a river. But at flood stage, it was dangerous. It could easily kill you. And so here they're having to go into the river. And God says, I want you to step into it. And the last time with Red Sea, God kind of opened it up. And then they could walk through. Now God's doing something different. And God changes up his miracles. God loves variety. He does. Look down the row. Look at other people. You see how different everybody is? God loves variety. And the miracles he did the first 20 years of this church, he's going to do different miracles. The miracles he's done in your life up until now, it'll look differently. Sometimes we tend to think, well, it's going to be just like it was. No, actually, God loves variety. He changes things up. And that's what he does here. He says, I want, you know, you get in the water. Just take your step in. And so Joshua sends the priests in first, you know, just kind of, okay, let's send the pastors in. And, you know, that goes to their ankle and to their knee. I can just picture going all the way up. They're going, okay, God, when are you going to do this? And then somehow the river goes down, even though it was happened 17 miles up north. You know, in the perfect timing, right when they needed to happen, right before the priests are about to go under. Here's the point of that, though, is that the first step is the most important. It's the scariest. Taking the first step is the hardest. So you step out, knowing that, you know, God's going to see me through this. Let me ask you a personal question. What is your Jordan? God's got a plan for you. There will be something that's scary, something challenging, something difficult that you're going to have to step out and go into that is incredibly difficult, could cause you fear or discouragement. It's your personal Jordan. You've got to walk into it. I want to read you some names, see if you recognize any of these Bible names. Shaphat, Palti, Galdiel, Amiel, or here's Sethur, Nabi, Guru, Egal. Those sound familiar? Probably not too many of you named your kid Egal, right? Gadi, Shamua, he's down in SeaWorld. You recognize those names? Those are the first 10 spies. Then you have Joshua and Caleb. Now, everybody hears of Joshua and Caleb. They're the ones that came back with a good report. Nobody remembers the people with the negative report. Nobody remembers the people who say it can't be done. People remember the people who say, we can do it with God's help. If we're going to accomplish what God has for this church in the next decade, we're going to need Joshua's and Caleb's. We're going to need people with people are willing to make a plan, people willing to build their life on God's word, people are willing to take steps, risk-taking steps in faith. That's what it's going to take. And it'll take that individually from you, but it's also going to take that as a church, as we do what God's called us to do corporately. Okay? Let's stand and we'll close in prayer. Well, let's kind of just position ourselves in these next few moments before the Lord. I was in my closing, I asked you, what's your Jordan? The other way to look at that is this. Are you going to live on the side of the desert? Or are you going to live in the promised land? Are you going to live with what God's promise and his blessing, what he wants for you? And he says, you get to choose. It's good. It is blessing. But you choose life or you choose death. You choose blessings. You choose curse. You can live in wandering in the desert, in the wilderness. And there's a lot of people. You have a lot of company. Or you can say, you know what? I'm done living in the wilderness. I want to step out. It might be scary, and I could, and God says, don't be afraid. It could get tough, and God says, don't get discouraged. Lord, I know that in our country, we uphold that value of individualism. And I like it. I'm very much like that. And I appreciate that value. But sometimes that value can be self-destructive. As the African proverb says, if you're going to go short distance, go alone. If you're going a long way, you go as a team. You go together. Nobody does Everest alone. So, Lord, as we're looking at something as important as our life plan, I pray, Father, for your blessing on that. That people that maybe have never stepped out of their comfort zone, maybe your Jordan is joining a connect group for the first time. You've had all your reasons why you won't be in a small group. And I'm going to challenge you, at least for the month of January, step into that. Step into that. It is worth it. It is worth it. We'll show you how to write up a life plan, attach goals to it. We're going to do it together. Lord, I just pray for everyone here, every soul that's accountable for their life before you, that, Lord, that from this day forward, we will use our life for the greatest purpose of all, which is your purpose. Lord, I pray that you speak to us, you reveal your word to us. Lord, I pray that we sensitively and with clarity are able to write down what we sense you wanting us to do. Now I want you to pray, just in your mind or just quietly where you're at. Would you say, dear God, I'm scared, but I want to take these steps. I want to make a plan. I've planned so many other areas of my life. It's time for me to plan my life. Would you say, God, I want to be used by you. Help me not just to know what your word says, but to study it, meditate on it. Do it. Some of you, your Jordan might be really stepping into that. You need to start off by taking 201, or Vineyard 201, or do it again. And then would you say, God, I want to step out in courage. Whatever that is, whether it's being part of a small group or tithing or reading my Bible, going back to school. It could be a number of things. You say, God, I want to be willing to do that. Help me, God. Would you say, God, help me to fulfill my destiny? If you've never asked Christ into your life, why not do that right now? Say, Jesus Christ, come into my life. Direct me. Guide me. Impart wisdom to me. In Jesus' name, amen.